and we'll see everyone.
God is not an accountant. God is not keeping track of the good things we do and the bad things we do. There is no tally taking place. There are no scales being weighed at all. This is the childish, really a part of the defense system of the ego to believe that God is some kind of accountant, keeping track of our every move, everything we do, everything we say, everything we think, everything we believe, keeping track of it all, you know, intensely, taping it all being recorded. And that we're going to be judged, and God is going to say, okay, well, I remember back then in 2012, what is it, August? I guess it's 17th. Yeah, that you thought this or you thought that, you did this or you did that, and that was good, but then the other stuff wasn't so good, and we need to, look at review and how your progress is coming and all this stuff. That is absolutely not true one bit. God pays absolutely no attention at all to whatever we're doing in this dream of existence, this actual hypothetical scenario where we're trying to manufacture a power. Because God knows perfectly well what God created everything flawless, perfect. So, and God knows that we continue to be this flawless perfection. There's no need to keep track of what stick figures are doing in a dream. And maybe this will come as a great relief to some of you who realize, no, there's none of this judgment of God is not keeping track of what you're doing and judging you on what you're doing in this dream. All that God does is provide the way to gently pick up a new cause so that we'll have the effects of that new cause. At the same time, gently set down the cause that we picked up, the cause of trying to be prime creator, trying to change reality, trying to get God to change reality, trying to develop a power. And again, mind is all powerful to present experiencing, but it has no power to create a power. Okay, it didn't create its own power. Mind, we don't have any power to create a power. The prime creator created all power, the power of the mind, the power of the spirit, the availability of all ideas, the functioning of reality, all that the prime creator created. So we don't have the ability to create any power. Prime creator knows that. So what's the prime creator worried about us? A dream that we're having, not concerned in the slightest bit, paying no attention to it. Simply sent the answer, voice of reason, voice of clarification, the capacity to clarify, to pick up a new cause, the cause of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to change reality, therefore not needing to try and manufacture any power to coerce God to change reality, not needing to do any of that, which then results in this flawless, seamless, unchanging effect of unconditional love that we have that to look forward to as soon as we give up this foolish attempt. And yet here we are trying to earn our way into heaven, earn our way into heaven. Could anything be more silly than that? We say, well, we want to live a good life, we want to serve others, help others, feed the poor, clothe the poor, feed the poor, take care of others, and that way we're going to earn our way into heaven. The only way you get into heaven is if you choose a new idea. It's the only way. How can you get into heaven? Getting into heaven means to return to full recognition and functioning in reality, to embrace reality, the functioning of reality once again, and to realize your place in reality, which is perfect freedom, perfect functionality. But again, We are not the ones who created this perfect functionality. You see, we're not Prime Creator. We cannot earn our way into heaven. We do it by choosing a new idea. That's it. If we don't do that, how can we bring the idea of trying to change reality, how can we bring that into reality? We cannot. We can only bring it into a dream, because reality can't be changed. So how can we entertain this idea of changing reality? Only in a dream, only in a hypothetical scenario that we're imagining. That's the only way we can do it. We can only entertain it that way. So God is not an accountant. That's a lesson of what God is not. It sometimes is helpful to point out what God is not. God is not this, God is not that, God not that, not that, not that. There's so many, many beliefs in what God is this, and it's simply not true at all. God is completely unconcerned with this plan that we have been pursuing. Knows that it's futile from the very beginning, and it's simply a waste of our time. We're simply wandering around aimlessly in a nightmare of loss, trying to manufacture this power that then we can come to God and say, okay, God, you have to come to the bargaining table. You have to change reality for us, or else we're going to get rid of all our reality, because we've got this power of destructivity. Why do you think everything in existence dies, decays, passes away? Everything. Why? We're trying to manufacture power. We're frantically experimenting in manufacturing, trying to find a way to build up some power. All we're doing is simply suffering. At least these symbols are suffering. Our mind is engaged in nightmares of loss, dreams of loss, and seems horrible. That's all we're doing. We're not building anything up. If we look at our how much we've progressed towards building up a power, the answer is zero. Not progressed at all. That account is zero. So on the other hand, there's nothing to lose. We don't have anything to lose. God is not an accountant. So don't worry about the good things you're doing. Don't think that, okay, I need to do all these good works. It's not true. We're saved simply because what we're doing can never work. We're already saved. Everyone's already saved, actually. There's nothing to be saved from, except we simply need to pick up a different cause, different idea. That is true. We have to repent. We have to pick up a different idea. We have to say, okay, the idea we've been pursuing doesn't work, won't work. No possibility of it working. And then we say, oh, okay, great. Let's pick up a new idea. Let's stop trying to coerce God into changing reality. We cannot create a power. We cannot. Now, these times are the best of times, the worst of times. We're living right now. It's both easier to be free, and it's harder to be free, depending where you're at. If you are, if you're able to see the two different belief systems, one question that you need to ask yourself, it's the simplest question possible, is can God change reality, or can God not change reality? Which is it? In asking that question, you will realize that it can't be both. God cannot both change reality and not change reality. That's not possible. Anyone can see that. And when you see that, literally, you will know that you are saved. You're free. You say, my gosh, it can't be both. That's basically the entirety of teaching right there, is it can't be both. You just have to ask the right question. Either God can change reality or God can't change reality. Can't possibly be both. So then again, you suddenly say, oh my gosh, it's either one or the other. If you believe in one, God can, there's a certain belief system that automatically arises from that. And if you believe cannot, there's another belief system that automatically arises from that. And you can see it. You can just say, you can trace it. You can say, it's easy to see it. Of course, of course, of course. And from this standpoint, it's easy to see what's going on in the world. And all day long, this clarity is just expanding and generalizing and seeing. And I just sit there and say, oh my gosh, I see this and this and this and this and this. Obvious now what's taking place in the world. So when you ask yourself this question, I say, okay, it has to be one or the other. So now if you're choosing that you believe God can change reality, you're going to now be in a situation where you feel like you're almost going to succeed, because a tremendous amount of loss is coming up, and that is your ticket, you believe, to coercing the Prime Creator to change reality, because you believe that you will, this display of loss will be so overwhelming to the Prime Creator that the Prime Creator will actually, what is happening now is we're almost to the point of severe loss, and people feel the Prime Creator is going to crack, and looking and seeing, oh my gosh, here comes the avalanche. The Prime Creator is going to say, okay, 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 okay. I give in. I'll change reality for you. So we're right before this huge planetary sacrifice that is going to take place. We're in a situation where we believe that the Prime Creator is going to crack. And so we're all, you know, expecting it. So from that standpoint, it's very difficult to give up on that. Very difficult. Because we're almost sure that the Prime Creator is finally going to relent, and then we'll get what we want after all this time. On the other hand, if you know that Prime Creator cannot change reality, then you say, oh my gosh, this lost scenario is going to go through, because the only way it gets stopped is if Prime Creator relents and cracks, and we know that's not possible. And you say, holy cow, I better shift over to pick up another idea, the idea of not trying to change reality, and experience the feeling of no loss, be in the idea of no loss at all. Get that feeling of nothing can be lost, nothing can be harmed, nothing can be threatened. I better go for that right away. If I don't go for that, I'm really going to experience this terrible meltdown, you know, the sacrificial meltdown of the planet, as it were. On all levels, meltdown on all levels, even all through and through, A to Z. So from that standpoint, it provides a tremendous push to say, wow, need to do it now. Let's do it now. So again, it's the best of times, the worst of times. It's a time when we're most reluctant to give up on this plan of trying to intimidate the Prime Creator through the fear of loss. We go to the Prime Creator and we say, Prime Creator, look how terrified we are of loss. And you created us, so therefore we are one with you, and you must have the same fear of loss. Now, the remedy is for you to change reality for us. You know, we think we just can't give up on this. It's we've set the stage. We've set the stage so brilliantly. But I know from experience that Prime Creator does not bite at this. Cannot. And so what happens is we throw ourselves into the sacrificial fire. Unfortunately, that's what happens. So we don't want to do that. Don't want to do that. That is not a wise thing to do. Therefore, those who believe that Prime Creator cannot change reality are in a good spot right now. Urgent spot. Time of urgency to accept a feeling of lost freeness. And essentially that means free of death, free of suffering, free of sickness. The whole complex of loss is replaced by the immaculate unconditional love of no loss, the whole complex is replaced. And we're right at this point where we can do that. That can be done. It can always be done, but we rarely have the urgency to do it. Rarely. We all keep thinking, well, this is kind of interesting, this whole showdown with the Prime Creator is very interesting. Let's see what happens. So let's get some popcorn and a drink and see what happens and just kick back. That is generally the way we are in this world, which is why so few have really been freed from this whole scenario of loss. Because we kind of wonder what's going to happen. It's interesting to us. We don't know. We think we don't know, but I do know, because I know for a fact the Prime Creator cannot change reality. So the game is really not interesting anymore. You already know the outcome, which is no deal. No deal, that is the outcome. So, you know, it loses its interest then. It becomes very boring, you know. My gosh, I was sitting around waiting for nothing. Nothing's, you know. We're not going to be Prime Creator. Prime Creator is not going to agree to any deal. It's impossible. Cannot. Literally impossible. We're wasting our time. So from that standpoint, you know, it's not so interesting. And you want to say, enough. Let's choose the idea of non-loss. Now, what I've found is in clarifying all of this, I find that I can find nothing in the world that reflects this back to me, that validates this, that's commensurate with this, that gives me this feeling like, see, this shows that the clarity, nothing. I can't find it. I cannot find it. Searching. No videos on YouTube, no nothing anywhere. The most beautiful place in the world cannot shine back to you, cannot reflect back to you the complete clarity of this scenario that we're involved in. So where can you get it except internally? Where can you get the confirmation except internally? You can't get confirmation from the world. Cannot. Therein lies the dilemma or the problem. And basically we have to turn within during these times. And something internally has to corroborate and to confirm and to present something that is validates. The validation has to come within. That's the word. Once you arrive at this point of seeing the two belief systems so clearly, and seeing the entire scheme of existence so clearly and all of that, then you look for validation and you can't find it externally. You cannot find it. Not even in the gurus externally. You cannot find it. So from that point, the only only direction to go is internally. External cannot provide the right kind of validation. Cannot. I mean, you know, a vacation to Hawaii is not going to do it. A golfing vacation, you know, to Palm Springs isn't going to do it. It's not going to provide the validation. Because seeing the entirety of the situation, that is completely profound. And external, everything external, you know, it is, you just realize, my gosh, can't receive any validation whatsoever for this. Because existence just, you know, it's just like, nothing, no validation. I don't feel the slightest validation from anything external. Doesn't matter how beautiful it is, luxurious, doesn't validate the clarity of seeing the entire situation. So, validation has to come from within. Don't expect, as long as we're looking for validation externally, we'll be lost. And that is a huge, huge problem. We're taught to look for external validation. And truth can never be validated externally. Because there's nothing external to truth. When we're looking externally, we're looking at lies. We're looking at a hypothetical, imaginary scenario that can never be true. We're looking at what we see is a vast generator of the power of loss. That's what we're looking at. And that can't validate the realization that all of this is futile. How can the realization that external, all this dream, all this hypothetical scenario, this attempt to manufacture power is completely futile. How can you get that validated by looking at this vast generator of loss? It just keeps generating loss. It doesn't stop. It doesn't invalidate itself. No, not at all. So it just simply isn't possible. But we do try to look for external validation. We're taught. The reason why we're taught that is because it doesn't work. It invalidates our deepest knowing. When we look externally, it's like invalidating our deepest knowing, because our deepest knowing is that all this is completely futile and worthless and will never work. And yet, if we're taught to look externally, the external world is just continuously acting as if it will succeed. It's completely going right along with all the loss that it's generating. Yeah, there was a rat last night out on its doing its thing, and this morning it was dead on the street. And I said, well, I could pick it up and put it in the trash, but you know what? I have a feeling that the crows are going to take care of it. So later on, I came back and there were the crows taking care of it. And then I came back later, end of the day, not a trace. Not a trace of that rat, gone. Last evening, the rat seems to be all alive, and you know, now, not a trace. See? Everything like in the world vanishes without a trace. Most everything, you know, vanish without a trace. Lost, gone. And so we go to the Prime Creator and say, look at this, look what we can do to life. We can make it vanish without a trace. So external, that which is external, is constantly invalidating truth, trying to invalidate truth, trying to say that Prime Creator can change reality. Otherwise, none of this would be necessary at all. The very fact that it's here means there's a belief that the Prime Creator can change reality. Otherwise, none of this would even be here in the first place. So it cannot get the validation externally. And so we, how do you get it internally is the question, you know? And that's what, I'm working on that right now. I'm working on that. Have to. I can't get it externally. You know, no matter what song, you know, you look for videos, movies, maybe a great song doesn't do it at all. Zero. There's no validation. So I'm kind of like, wow, you know, uh-oh. This realization that it cannot be validated externally is very strong realization. So I realize I have to turn within to be validated. That's the only place to go now. Turn within. When we talk about we're coming up to a dead end, externally we are. We're coming up to very much of a dead end. Vast, severe, loss-based scenario. And in seeing this, I kept wondering, you know, how do you escape this? How do you get free of this? It's a dead end. We're at a dead end. Well, it seems as though turning within is the way to do it. That truth becomes validated from within, not externally. And it seems like we're heading into terra incognita. By turning within, what does that mean? We've heard that. I've heard it. And I cannot answer that specifically at this moment, but I'm setting the stage for it here. Setting the stage. We can turn within. It seems like that is what we must do. We must do. And we must stop seeking validation externally from anyone. validation. Now, advice is a different thing. That's okay. But validation, to say, yes, I know that Prime Creator cannot change reality. How do we get that validated? We can see it conceptually. We can see it with reason. I can see it extremely clearly now. But where is the validation of that? Because concepts are not enough. We need a deeper validation. And I look at the world, say, oh my gosh, I go back in time, go in the future. Where do you find validation externally? Nah, it's just not available. You can't go down to the store and buy it. You can't go down and get a movie and that'll validate this fact that Prime Creator cannot change reality. Where do you... So... have to turn within. Now, in looking at this necessity to turn within, to look within, to be validated from within, some clarity really, really came up here. Super important. The feeling of no loss is the validation. I can see that. But if we are not really accepting that the Prime Creator cannot change reality, we will take this as this feeling begins to permeate us from within, arise from within, to saturate us. We will take it the wrong way. We will think that the Prime Creator is trying to somehow imprison us. And we'll be frightened by it. Because if we believe that the Prime Creator can change reality, then we think that the Prime Creator is threatened by us, by what we're doing, and is trying to somehow imprison us in a certain way, so we cannot continue to work on loss. So it is very possible to take this experience of no loss, take it the wrong way, and freak out, which is again why drugs are so bad, because it's possible to get certain patterns that seem to point in that direction, and then the freak out, you know, comes, because you start thinking about it and you say, well, wait a minute, maybe I'm being imprisoned. You know, first the people feel like, wow, this is like I'm one with everything and I'm suffering any loss is incredible. And then they start gradually, the ego starts reconstituting, their belief system starts reconstituting, and they start saying, wait a minute, whoa, maybe this is a trick, maybe it's a trap, you know, and then paranoia, kaboom, and then the great trip turns into a terrible trip. You know, and I grew up in this whole situation of people taking trips. And I mean, it was just everywhere, all the literature, the writing is just, society was permeated with, at a certain level, with people taking drugs trips constantly and reporting about them. And in reading those reports, I saw, wait a minute, you know, it's very, very consistent in that at some point, things take a negative turn and people start freaking out. And that's the fear is that people might have a whole bunch of good trips, and suddenly they have a terrible one, and they freak out. And that is not the way. And then they really, it destabilizes them, you know, very bad. And I can see it very clearly now that, why? Easy to see why. Because if you have not really seen clearly the root of the whole situation, then, and you're still like just kind of vacillating and don't really see the obvious choice as it is, but you're just jumping from one belief system to the other without seeing the root and the purpose, and you're aligned properly, then at some point you're going to suddenly start thinking, oh, wait a minute, perhaps the Prime Creator is just giving me this loss free experience to prevent me from continuing to work on loss, because the Prime Creator feels extremely threatened by my work on loss. And so this is really like an eternal imprisonment in this loss-free feeling, and I'll never get what I really want. And it just starts building and just kaboom into this horrendous freak out. The paranoia just, you know, goes rampant. And then you say, oh my gosh, how do I get out of this? I never want to see that again. It's a trick. And the mind is unstable, cannot put it in the right context at all. And it just, people went into complete freak out, hysterical, and their mind is just spinning, and they're caught up in endless webs of paranoia. And it's horrible, horrible, horrible. I mean, so many people freaked out and had to be put on tranquilizers and other drugs to try and just, you know, calm the mind down. Very dangerous thing. Drugs are more dangerous than people realize. There's a safe way to do it, and that is to relentlessly keep on clarifying. Be entirely sober, and just in a very sober, serious, calm, confident way, keep on examining, looking, and pay attention, and connect the dots, keep connecting the dots, keep working your way back to the root of existence, the purpose of existence. I've done it, so I know you can do it, because you have the capability to do it. And then at that point, once that's all been clarified, then looking within and being validated internally, it becomes a safe option. You're not going to freak out. I don't get the feeling I'm going to freak out, you know. But the terrible drug culture that started in the late 50s and then exploded in the 60s and has been going ever since has woven a tremendous false narrative around the entire situation, and has really caused enormous, enormous difficulty. Terrible. Because you have all this freak out, all this stuff, and people saying, wow, it's dangerous. You know, you get this whole feeling like it's really tricky. It's dangerous. God is somehow tricky, dangerous. This entire notion, there's this extreme notion in our defenses that somehow the approach to God is very technical and tricky, and if you do the wrong thing, kaboom. Totally false. That is absolutely a false narrative. And yet it's there. It is there very strongly. And so I've been like defusing this for a long, 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 long time. Very carefully defusing the supposed danger, until the point of seeing that there is no danger at all. Unless you try to force the issue somehow. And forcing the issue is not the way at all. You don't need to force it. That's the lazy way. You know, let's just take some drug and see if we can force the issue. Very foolish. And it ends up making it much more difficult for others to succeed, because there's all these reports about, yeah, I met God, I was one with God, but then all this stuff happened and blah, blah, blah. It's like, whoa, you know, or the Kundalini arose and it was terrible internal stuff and I was freaked out and it was horrible. And it's like, whoa, you know, wow, God is dangerous. It's not true. God is not an accountant, and God is not dangerous. Approaching God is not dangerous if you really are approaching it truly through the means that are given us, which is the voice of reason, the capability to clarify, to contemplate, to see with the eyes of reason and clarification and understanding. If you use that way, which is the way it is given to us, the Prime Creator gave us that way. You're not forcing anything. You're simply seeing and recognizing the obstacles that have been put in the way and then discarding them and say, okay, that's not a real obstacle at all. And that's what's been happening to me more and more and more. Today was tremendous acceleration in that as I prepare to be validated from within. Recognizing, yeah, that the ways of trying to force the issue brought about severe backlash and a kind of an inner paranoia like God is dangerous. God has to be approached carefully. If you say the wrong thing, you know, if you got the wrong attitude, all this stuff, you're going to be driven into severe fear and all this stuff. But my situation here is not an attitude. It is simply a clarity. Saying, I see the two belief systems. I see what one leads to. All fear comes from the belief system of believing that God can change reality. All fear comes from that. The other one, that God cannot change reality, no fear comes from that at all. None. No fear there at all. So one belief system has all the fear and the other one has none of the fear. That is a fact. But all these magical mystery tour, you know, psychonauts who voyaged internally into all their subtle energy patterns through drugs and various energy exercises and stuff. They came back, you know, telling all these tales and scary tales. It's like, wow, this is really a lot of instability. You know, a lot of instability there. I don't want that. So it kind of dissuades the rest of us from even trying, you know? And you get these some crazy gurus who also dissuade us from trying. So, wow, I don't want to be like that. Wow, God's kind of unstable, you know? You get these gurus claiming they're God, and these gurus end up acting really unstable manner. And you say, holy smokes, you know, boy, the God is kind of weird, and the inner validation must be unstable. It's kind of, you know, wow, got to stay away from that. Let's just stay with the conceptual. It seems very safe. So you get all these very mischievous stuff going on in this world by those who are still believing they can, that God can change reality, and they think God's bluffing. And so they're working some very clever angles on this. And that makes it very difficult for the rest of us, really. And yet, it's there, you know. You got to deal with it. You got to get past it. And it will always be there. It will always be there that these angles are being worked and frightening us. We're thinking, uh-oh. Oh boy, this, I don't know if I've got the technical expertise, you know, to navigate the inner sea, as it were, you know. But we're not navigating energy patterns, you see. That's not what it is. The experience of unconditional love is not an energy pattern that you need to navigate. It is simply the feeling of no loss. That's what I'm looking forward to. That's what I'm aiming at. I'm not expecting any psychedelic trip or some, you know, all the stuff that all these psychotropic, what would you just call them? Psychonauts. Psychonauts. You know, reported all this stuff. I'm not interested in any of that stuff. I mean, I can do videos, you know, special effects that duplicate, you know, most of these effects, you know, really. It's possible now. And, you know, you can do all these fractals and all these geometric stuff and all these, you know, things. And it's just, you know, subtle energy patterns, etc. That's not the goal at all. It's got nothing to do with the goal. The goal is to feel, experience no loss. Have no feeling of loss. That is the goal. That is the goal. When you give up trying to manufacture loss, what do? you have the feeling of no loss. You're not feeling any loss anywhere whatsoever. You've given up that effort to manufacture loss. And yet again, this has come from within. It can't come from this effort to manufacture loss. Cannot give you the experience of no loss. Cannot validate your conceptual clarity with the actual experience. Cannot do it. Cannot do it. So we need to turn around and we need to go within and we need to get past those obstacles that have been put there by those who were just fooling around and tripping and came back telling us, hey, that they saw it all, they know it all. And whether tripping is on drugs or meditation or whatever way they're tripping, you know, we have to get past all their narrative entirely. And that's what I've been working on for all these years. I know a lot about that narrative, and because I've been working on it to defuse the whole darn thing. We really put ourselves in a very bad position. The entire movement of drugs of any kind, really. And in the past, of course, they used naturally occurring drugs, psychotropic drugs. What do you call it? Ethnogens, something like that. And from time immemorial, people have been using those. The mushrooms and the cactus and the various drinks, you know, the mold on rye and things like that, and precursors to, you know, various synthetic drugs we have now. And again, that built up a false narrative too. So the false narrative in this planet has always been there. The idea that somehow you can take something external to validate truth. It's not true. It's not that way. Can't be done that way. It builds up a false narrative, and we've been trapped in that false narrative for so long that, you know, we're afraid to take a step to get the true validation. In the ashrams of the real teachers, the real heavyweights, you can't take drugs. No way. No way. You're supposed to live a very righteous life in terms of, you know, vegetarian diet, no drugs of any, no stimulants, none of that stuff, cigarettes, caffeine, no drugs of any type, forget it. But so many gurus, I think, in a desire to get famous, they kind of like said, hey, it's all cool, man, I'll even partake with you, let's all have a party, you know. And of course, Westerners said, hey, here's a really cool guru. He's a very hip guru. Everyone was looking for the hip gurus who were, anything goes, you know. Let's all get drunk and high and take off our clothes. It's all cool, you know, who cares? Everything goes. Let's tolerate everything. Those were idiots, and that built up a false narrative, very much a false narrative that we are now, that is what blockades us from turning within and getting the validation that we need at this time. It was done purposefully. From my perspective, this whole sacrificial scenario is being set up very cleverly. I've been aware of the whole thing, just observing it and noticing it. And you had all these, you know, hip gurus come into the world and build up this false narrative to block our way, because now we're afraid to turn within. So we keep clinging to externals, trying to find something externally to save us. And we'll end up getting thrown into the fire. That is a fact. So, you know, believe me, I have not been happy at all with these false gurus. Not in the slightest bit. Very displeased with them, to say the least. Because they really, really threw up nasty, nasty barrier on us. And I don't know, maybe I'll start calling them out on it. I don't know. It's possible. If that's helpful for anybody. I don't know. Maybe it will. Maybe it will be helpful at this point. Because I'm seeing what they did. What they did is a very nasty trick. Very nasty trick. they got us all into this false narrative, and now we're terrified. Say, oh my God, God is crazy, you know. So, we're afraid to turn within. We are afraid to do it. I can feel it there. I can feel that this false narrative saying, where did this come from? Because I know there should be no fear. I know it's perfectly safe. Because in this belief system, you know, that God can't change reality, I see there's no fear whatsoever. It is perfectly safe to do it. And yet, I feel that there's this fear there. And it's coming from this other belief system. And it's been built up, intentionally built up to trap us into this sacrificial scenario. So that more loss gets built up. These super hip gurus who claim to be God, what they want is they want us to be sacrificed. They want to build up more power sacrifice so they can be greater than God. These fake gurus want to, you know, that is the playing out of the desire to be greater than God. And they say, well, I just don't have enough leverage yet because God hasn't cracked and changed reality for me so I can be greater than God. So I need all you little lemmings down here, you sheep, to sacrifice your lives for me. And so then I can get the leverage I need to make, force God to the table and make a deal. So they generate this deep fear of the inner, of turning within, by pretending to lead everyone within, and then messing everything up, you know, horrible. And then people just are paranoid now about turning within. Nasty, nasty trick, really. Not happy about that at all. I might say something about specifically, I don't know, possible. Some specific teachers is possible I might say something about it. I haven't decided that one yet. I'm keeping it in general terms, you know, because you can understand what I'm talking about. Is we have been conditioned to be afraid to look within, to receive the validity that is there. Because the validity is there, and it is this unconditional love that validates the fact that all our effort to force God into a deal to change reality was useless and meaningless and didn't do anything, and validates that God is not angry at us at all, because there was no possibility of it ever working. Reality wasn't threatened. So God's just waiting for us to accept this and welcome us back to reality, as it were. We're still there, but welcome us back to our full embrace of reality instead of trying to build some power up to threaten God. We now drop that. And this unconditional love, this feeling of no loss, there's no possibility of feeling lost no matter what happens externally, cannot touch this lossless feeling. That is there for us. That is there for us. And yet we are paranoid to turn in that direction because we've been burned. And this burning was done intentionally. It's done intentionally. That's the ego. The ego plays hardball. Okay, I mean, this whole scenario of trying to manufacture a power to threaten reality, it plays hardball. And if you ever played hardball, you know what I'm talking about. I did. I wanted to be a baseball player. I was very, very good at baseball. And when I was young, and I played, you know, with first wiffle ball, and then and the softball, 10-inch, 12-inch, and then eventually hardball. And the difference, you know, hardball, you know that when that ball is coming at you, you know, if you're batting and it's, you know, you get hit, it hurts. It hurts. It's not a joke. It's not a joke. I mean, it really hurts. And you're playing in the field, you know, and you get, you know, hit in the face or something, you know, it hurts. And when that ball's coming at you, you know, 110, 20 miles an hour, poof, line drive, you know, you got to make the catch. I mean, you got to deal with this hard ball coming at you. And it's a whole different thing, It's not a joke. So the ego, the effort to manufacture a power that can threaten God into making a deal and changing reality, that effort plays hardball. You know, it's not a joke. It literally is trying to force everyone into this sacrificial situation to continue to sacrifice their lives, their gross body, dense body, subtler body, sacrifice all of that. And it does that by, again, seeming to frighten you away from turning to where the validation is. The whole drug culture did that, and the and before that, there were other ways and means. But let us deal with recent history that we can really sink our teeth into, and all then the crazy gurus and you know the swinging gurus, the hip gurus, all this stuff who you know had a bunch of cleverness and subtle on the subtle energy levels that really impressed us. Wow, you know you can do that. Whoa. You know, they could manipulate because from the, you know, subtler energy patterns. So what? Doesn't mean anything. The fact is they didn't have any clarity at all about the situation, about the root of a purpose of existence and about the root of it. And I look at them, I pay attention to them, and I said, well, you know, where's the beef? I mean, where's the clarity? It's not there. They didn't have it. But they could do a whole bunch of groovy energy stuff, you know, and gullible people or people who are part of their little song and dance would, you know, get into that, and then they later, you know, years later, they'd freak out, have this terrible freak out, and say, "Oh my God, we were abused. It was a cult. It was so terrible. This stuff, don't stay away from this." You know, and that, you know, it poisons the well, as it were. And now we're sitting here shaking and trembling, saying, "Oh my gosh, I need to turn within to get this lost feeling to be validated." Validation, to receive the real validation of peace beyond understanding, this loss-free, unconditional love, this feeling of no loss. And we're all shaken with terror, you know. That just didn't come from nowhere. I mean, it arises from our confusion, but even when we're clear, it's still there, and we realize it's been helped along. There's been all this clever defensiveness taking place, obstacles set up to frighten us. Boogeyman, you know, the boogeyman's there. So, you know, it's possible I may start, you know, saying some stuff about this. Maybe it's even probable. I don't know how I'm going to feel about that in the morning or later tonight. But generally, I've always said, don't get into that, you know, don't criticize anybody specifically. But then again, you know, this is hardball. Hardball goes both ways, you know. If you're going to play hardball, it's going to come back at you as hardball, so to speak. And this building up, this dread and mistrust of the inner validation of what reason can show you. That's playing hardball, you know. It's playing hardball. And it's literally, if we don't get past it, we are literally going to be fed into the flames of sacrifice. And the sacrifice that's coming up, again, as I've said in other videos, it's to brutalize us. It's to brutalize our subtle energy bodies. And then also eventually the physical body too. But it's not just the physical, it is a brutalization of all the subtle bodies. Horrible thing that's coming up. It is to make you feel you're nothing, and you're completely stupid, and you're completely helpless, completely hopeless. It's to shrink you down into annihilation, you know, a feeling of total chaos and just freak you out completely. And this is very escapable, because you can turn within and allow that feeling, the lost free feeling, to permeate you from within, and then all of the sacrifice won't cause the slightest ripple in your equanimity. You'll radiate this lost freeness and perfect assurance, you know. You'll be realized, truly realized. It is possible for all of us to do that. All of us. And yet there is this fear to let that happen, thinking that, you know, it's not stable or something, because all these knuckleheads came in and played us for fools. And I wasn't, you know, I investigated all of it, and I kind of saw through it, and it was like, whoa, it was pretty difficult to see the totality of the situation and put it all in the right context. So I couldn't really speak up with courage at the time, because I felt I was going to be, you know, stomped. I don't feel like I'm going to be stomped at this point, but we'll see. Because, like I said, those who are doing that are doing it for a purpose. And they're very serious about their purpose, because they really feel their salvation is dependent on sacrifice and building up the power of death, of loss, to then force the Prime Creator into changing reality. They really believe that. So they're really into it, you know, but it's complete delusion. There's no possibility. The Prime Creator cannot change reality. Reality is the Prime Creator. It's again, reality, every power, everything in reality is shared equally everywhere in reality. There's no inequality at all. There's no imbalance at all. If you were to change even the tiniest bit of reality, the whole thing would no longer be reality at all. So it cannot be changed. Perfect distribution, perfect equality can't be changed, because and still retain what it is. Cannot at all. Cannot be changed even in the slightest way. So the Prime Creator cannot change it, because the Prime Creator would no longer be Prime Creator. Would no longer be what it is. And there's no power to change what is. There is no such thing, no power. Like I said, the Prime Creator cannot change reality. And yet, you know, there's this vast effort to, doesn't believe that, thinks this is a bluff. And that we have to call this bluff. And we do it by bringing this threat to reality, saying we're going to destroy it. So that's why we're trying to manufacture this power of loss, of death, of destructivity, to frighten the Prime Creator. And the Prime Creator's not frightened, not frightened. But if we go into the inner believing that somehow our familiarity with the inner is going to accent our deal-making ability, that is when we get into trouble. And those teachers, gurus, simply did not put things in the right context at all. They did not. Some did. I point out the ones that did. Ramana Maharshi did. Ananda Maima did. Put it in the right context, absolutely. And there are probably some others too. Probably some others. Those are two very well-known ones. But there are others that did not. And in general, it's not been put in the right context. In general, it has not. Which is why we still have this fear. And we're looking to the teachers these days, you know, do they put it? They do not. They don't put it in the right context. And in doing that, there's too much dependence on the teacher. They're fostering dependence on themselves. They may be looking, as someone, one of the viewers here said, they're looking at a belief in enlightenment, you know. But they don't spell out the clarity of the context and the purpose to my satisfaction at all. And so that they track devotees who are into them. Something external, the guru, they're into the guru. Guru, you're so wonderful, you can save us. You know, they're looking for validation from the guru. That is not the way. The real gurus are not looking for ultimate validation. They're not saying, get it from them. They're saying, no. You must get it from within. You must get it from within. You cannot get it from anything external, including the greatest guru, even Ananda Maima. You cannot get it. The true validation, you can't get it, couldn't get it from her. You have to get it from within. Same with Ramana Maharshi, same thing. Can't get it from them. And they knew that. So they didn't foster that kind of dependency. They said, no, you got to do the work. You have to clarify. You have to overcome your reluctance to be validated from within. You have to do that. And that's why that's why they're great teachers, true teachers. like that. And fortunately for them, they have helped the world by helping us get past these tricksters, you know. These trickster gurus who are really trying to trap us into sacrifice. All right, you getting all of this? I am. This is kind of, you know, we're moving into more intense territory right now, which is okay, because it's necessary, because things are getting very, very, very worrisome in terms of sacrifice. I'm super attuned to the whole theme of sacrifice. Never have wanted it, never. So I've got, you know, very alert about it. And it is getting really, really late in the game. I mean, sacrifice, there's a whole buildup to it, towards it, whole buildup. And that's when the red flags are being tossed out right and left. And if you're wise, you can see them. Say, holy cow, they passed that law, they passed that decree, they passed that executive order, they did this, they did this. They're blocking us here, they're blocking us there. You can feel yourself being... They're putting like bars in the cage, like you're in a room and somebody is putting a bar here, putting a bar there, putting a bar there. They don't just do it, you know, straight across, because then you start freaking out and say, whoa, I gotta get out. They put one here, then over there, and so you still see gaps in it. But then suddenly they place one here and you say, whoa, that gap is gone. I can't get out there. I can't get out that way at all. So externally, the trap is being set. Step by step by step by clever step. It's being set. And again, the only escape is internal. Get the internal validation. And from that eternal validation, again, I know it opens up. It opens up the Passover principle entirely, which is automatic. And you will literally, one way or another, you will be translated into, if necessary, a loss-free realm even. And there is such a realm. It could be that you'd simply translate it back into reality. That is possible too. I don't know. Those are details we don't have to worry about at this point, because we still have to overcome this barrier of looking within. And, you know, I'm not seeing many do that, really look within. I'm not seeing that happening, because there is that barrier. I'm seeing situations that are less than that. Or I'm seeing situations where that's been glimpsed, but it's not steady. That is possible too. Where there's still a little bit of uncertainty, maybe. But as far as the full-on, loss-free feeling there, and full acceptance and embracing it, I'm not seeing it. Which means that there is some paranoia. There is still some concern. That was very cleverly laid there, you know, very cleverly laid there by, you know, dirty, rotten scoundrels, as it were. Desperados, spiritual desperados, you know, who thought they were almost there. They almost had God in their crosshairs. They just needed one more big sacrifice, you know, and they want to make sure. They're like the, you know, sheep herding dogs, like border collies, how they can herd a whole big herd of sheep, nipping at everyone's heels, you know, here, there, and you have one dog, two dogs, literally can move the entire flock of sheep, because they know how to do it, ruff, 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 you know, bark, 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 bite, 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 that kind of thing, scaring the sheep. Sheep are like, oh, you know, I better not go over that way, because this crazy dog is, you know, in my face, you know. But if you get like a dog, like a big dog dressed up in a sheep outfit and is in the flock too, and then suddenly the big dog turns to the little dog, yap, 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 is yapping, the big dog says, get out of my way, you know, and just moves right at the dog. Sheep herding dog is like, oh my gosh, you know, freaked out. This sheep is not afraid of me. What's going on? And then the big dog just leads the sheep in the right direction, saying, God, away from the sacrifice, you see. And the sheep herding dog is like, just like, how did that happen? Whoa, it's impossible. What happened? Some kind of mutation in the sheep? I don't get it. It's impossible. You know, it happened. It happened because not everybody that's here is a sheep. You see? Not everyone here is so easily buffaloed by that sheep herding, that border collie going, yep, 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 yep. And, you know, scaring us all. Not so easily scared. As the sun sets, I'm adjusting the exposure controls here because I get different lighting conditions. The sun is almost set now. So, yeah, what we need is some of those big dogs that have been wearing sheep's clothing to start barking back at the sheep herding dogs and saying, you know, get out of our way. We're going this way. You thought you're taking us that way, you know, but we're going, you know, this way, not that way. So that's very possible. Maybe it's time to do that. Maybe it's time to start barking back, playing a little hardball back, serving it back, returning serve, you know. I think it is, you know. I just have to see if I can, you know, handle that. It's not what I like to do. It's really not. I'd rather just, you know, dismiss the whole thing conceptually. But I know a lot of people have gotten burned. And you can't do it through... You got to do it through forgiveness. But forgiveness, what brings forgiveness? Clarity brings forgiveness. And sometimes, you know, truth-telling, you gotta see it. You gotta say, yeah, I really saw how this came about. Wow, okay, now you see it. And you say, oh, my gosh, that was just a song and dance to scare us away so that we would, you know, meekly march to our destruction, as it were. So that'll be interesting. That'll be interesting. I know there's some have asked me about, what about this teacher? What about that teacher? You know, I don't like to really say anything about that. But at least in this video, you're getting the gist of what I'm saying. We'll see how it can be done. Because you still have to see clearly. However, again, when we try to turn within to get validation, there's fear there. There's this amorphous, strange fear. We can't place it. We cannot place it. That is the problem. I'm telling you for sure that this entire, you know, drug culture and swinging guru, hip guru culture, everything we've gone through, you know, for the last 50 years almost on this planet, that threw us a curveball, threw us a knuckleball. Really threw us a knuckleball. You know, a knuckleball is not easy to hit. If you've ever tried to hit a knuckleball, I used to throw a knuckle curveball, and that was very difficult to hit as well. Almost unhittable. So there's some pitches that are hard to hit, and what happened was we got thrown a knuckleball here, and we keep swinging and missing and swinging and missing. I'm like, wow, you know, we can't hit this thing because didn't expect it. You know, it generated a fear that we just don't feel like we can deal with. We haven't figured out how to deal with it yet. I'm still figuring out how to deal with it. I'm still trying to figure that out. And I hope I get there. I believe I will. And I hope that all you get there too. You know, if we start hitting that knuckleball, maybe a lot of us will start hitting it. You know? If you can see as possible, you know, if the sheep realize, well, that border collie is not such a big deal after all, you know, just trying to intimidate us. And some big dog starts barking at the border collie, and the border collie goes, ooh, what the, you know, like, what was that? I didn't expect that from the sheep, you know? And it's a shame Moore didn't speak up earlier, but again, it was a knuckleball. We got thrown this knuckleball. We didn't really know how to deal with it, really. Because the all this inner stuff seems so groovy, you know, wow. And we're like, huh, I mean, is that, we have to go through that, you know, and is that territory, we have to sail through that territory? No, we do not. Bypass all of it. Again, I said, if someone wants to cut me off from all of existence and say, you'll never experience existence again, I say, fine. I'm not threatened by that. Go ahead. You know, not a problem. So we'll see. Maybe I'll do some videos and start pushing here. I don't know. That's something I'll have to see if there's any validation for doing this. Or is this sufficient? Just sufficient. Maybe it's just sufficient for simply to turn within and get the validation. Maybe that's sufficient. That definitely would be sufficient. Question is that automatically going to free others up to say, oh yeah, okay, it's all fine? Or are they going to say, well, maybe you just figured out a way to navigate all this trickiness or something, you know, and that fear may still be there? Very interesting question, isn't it? Very interesting question, because I tell you the truth, I don't feel people are not getting the inner validation. They're not getting it. So I'm looking at the situation saying, why? What is the holdup? We should be jumping into it, you know. We should be getting into that inner validation by this time. Absolutely. The next four and a half months are completely critical. Completely critical. And we've got to get that inner validation. And you can't do it through drugs or any other means of forcing it. You literally have to allow it to arise. There has to be this letting go. Say, okay, let go into it. Surrender into it. Allow the arising. Allow the permeating to take place. And I don't think it's such a... it's not an arising like Kundalini, but it's something that's a soft suffusion. Just sort of this extremely gentle, seamless suffusion that is just completely gentle. We have to then trust it. We have to allow it and then trust it. And again, this mistrust has been built up, which is hanging us all up. I don't want us to get all hung up, because I don't like people going through sacrifice. It's unnecessary, completely unnecessary. The whole sacrificial belief system is a complete fraud, and from the very beginning, completely futile. Completely futile. No one ever had to die. Never had to be any loss, ever. It was useless. It was futile from the very beginning. None of us had to dream these horrible dreams ever. And so obviously I don't want, you know, it can come to an end. We don't have to keep doing it. I don't want to see anyone keep doing this, keep dreaming these terrible dreams of sickness and death and all of that. Loss. It's not necessary. Never was necessary, because it's futile. Prime Creator cannot change reality. And so it doesn't matter what kind of power of coercion we think we can develop. It's useless to us. Useless. Useless, useless, useless. So, we'll see. We'll see how it goes from here. Stay tuned. Stay tuned. And, I don't know. I'm not... Yeah. We'll see. Don't know. I don't know at this point. But hopefully this has clued you in to the fact there is this distrust, mistrust, paranoia, uncertainty about getting inner validation. And so we keep trying to get external validation. And that's not going to work for us. It is not going to work for us. Because the external is going to absolutely invalidate the clarity that we have. It's going to invalidate it. And we don't want that. We don't want that. So getting inner validation is completely essential. And we have to do it soon. Because if we don't get it, we'll keep trying to get external validation, and that is going to really cause us problems in the future. And again, real internal validation, not some guru, some external, you know, guru. That's not enough. It's not enough. Only the actual internal validation will work for us. So we must get past the obstacles. We must get past those. And so I'll do whatever it takes to, you know, to help us all get past those. And maybe it's time to call out, you know, call it out, you know, the way that it is. I might have to do that. Again, not mean-spirited, not judgmental, because everyone is one, or one in spirit. But there are those who are trying to be greater, continuing to try and be greater than spirit, trying to be prime creator, and therefore they're pursuing that, and they're playing hardball with that. And we who want to get the validation that all this is futile and reality welcomes us home, we have the right to that validation. We have the right to it. And so we have the right to get past any sort of blockage whatsoever. We have that right to turn within. And we have the right to get past those obstacles, get past those fears. We have the right to get past those fears. Not attacking anybody at all, whatsoever. But to, you know, at least show that, hey, all this stuff was just generating mistrust of inner validation, and we need to say, reject that and say, no. You know, this was a fraud. This was set up to entrap us into sacrifice, and now we are rejecting that and saying no to it. You know, goodbye. You know, you don't intimidate us anymore. Didn't work. All right. We have to do that. We have to get past it. Have to do it. Okay. Very great. I'll end the video this time. Thanks to the music to Prasad Bhandakar, who produces the most incredibly great music in the world, in my opinion. He's just an incredible bansuri flute player. You can hear his music at bansuriflute.com, I believe. Prasad Bhandakar giving us this great, great flute music. And I'm just in using it in fair use to this educational and spiritual helpful video. Using it there in fair use. Thank you. And all right, very great. Let's see what comes next. That's it for this video.